You know, it's interesting. I worked in post years ago in Hollywood, and I knew some Australian guys who had worked their way through, and the owners are Australian, but they were actually working together in Singapore in post when they started the company. And the main owner said, well, I'm going to move it back to Australia because that's where I'm from, and start the manufacturing and get things going there. But over time, we've actually expanded to have engineering, a lot of it in Australia, but we also have some in Singapore with the Da Vinci acquisition, where I came from almost 8 years ago. You know, the Da Vinci team was the R&D team was in Singapore, so we have that office. And eventually we had to get another plant. So we had a production plant, our own, in Australia. Then the second plant we built in Singapore, because there were had some guys there already. And we actually opened a third plant now in Indonesia. So, you know, that's kind of expanded. But then engineering teams, as we acquire different companies, we have guys in the UK, we have guys in the US. So we have people, you know, wherever these companies that we purchased, one of the most recent acquisitions was Fairlight, the audio guys. They were Australian as well. So we they were based in Sydney. Our other guys are based in Melbourne. So today, Blackmagic is much more of an international company, still headquartered in Melbourne. So roughly close to 1,000 people worldwide, about half of them in Australia.
Does that include manufacturing?
Yes, yeah. But we, as I said, our manufacturing is all done internally, so we have our own plants. And that also helps us to be able to retool quickly to adjust to as needed. We're a lean manufacturing company, so we build as needed and are able to change with the times quickly because we're fairly small, but because of the agility of our manufacturing, we're able to grow as fast as we have. Well, it's interesting because I think because of the fact that we are a relatively young company, so we don't have a lot of legacy issues that would prevent that type of, you know, we still feel like we're on a speedboat, so we can do that dynamically. And the way that we've been able to parse engineering over product lines, so we have a UI team that works on the user interface for all the products, you know, and we can segment that. So we can move people around depending on how they're needed. We don't have those old school barriers of, oh, well, you can't talk to that department because this department and that department don't speak. We have a different type of structure where, in a sense, we sort of internally talk about how we all report to the product because we're just trying to make the products better, and it doesn't matter what department you're in. We don't have any of those issues. And as we have been acquiring companies, which has helped a lot of our growth, the guys that come in from these other companies notice that and they say, oh, wow, it's, you know, if I just need to get a resource, I can get a resource. I don't have to go through a hurdle or say, oh no, we never talked to that team. So those silos that occur in a lot of the bigger just don't occur, and it's just the way our owner kind of breeds that, to say, hey, we're all here in this together. No matter what product you're working on, you can help somebody else out, and we do. Well, it's a combination of both. I mean, at this point, we realize that we're fairly well established, but we also think that our spirit is still sort of youthful, if that's a term. In what I mean by that is, you know, we still kind of march to the beat of our own drum and continue to be able to do that, and we hope to continue to be able to do that. Although we've grown in size, our missions are the same. And the infrastructure and the structure of the way that we work is still the same, and so far so good in terms of being able to maintain that. And when we indoctrinate some new employees from acquisitions, we go through that a lot with them, and they get it. You know, they, and then a lot of them, I mean, most, I mean, what's funny to me is it's almost 8 years since I came with Da Vinci. I was the youngest guy at Da Vinci. I became the oldest guy at Blackmagic that weekend. But the fact is, all the guys that came at that time, we're all still here, you know, 8 years later. And as we introduced Ultimat and Fairlight, which were the two latest acquisitions, you know, the only thing that changed there was now I'm not the oldest person at Blackmagic, so that's good. I don't, you know, that's not something that we talk about or have talked about. You know, I never say never anymore because anytime I think we'll never do that, and oops, lo and behold. But I, at this point, we don't have any public intentions to do that. Well, I mean, he's in every part of it. I mean, he lives and breathes it. I think what's interesting to me is how involved he is with the products and you know, when they're finished. I mean, forget the design part. He, you know, he's always involved in that part. But even as they're being finished, he works with the guys on the software interface or the hardware. You know, he's plugging them in and you know, a lot of changes that have occurred to some of the products are a direct result of him saying, hey, why don't we have internal power supplies on these? Why we should do that? Or, you know what I mean? These are kind of noisy or whatever. You know, a lot of the software upgrades that have come, a lot of it does come from him. Or when people relate to him, he understands because he's, you know, he was a guy that worked in production and post-production. So it's not like he's just some generic CEO guy. He's a guy who knows this. He lives and breathes it. And so, you know, he really wants to get involved. I mean, I think on one of the press, you know, he was changing the mount on a camera live on a press conference. Yesterday he was doing a live demo of Resolve that he hadn't really played with much, but, you know, and, you know, that's just the kind of guy he is, yeah.